Alright, so in the previous session, I introduced you to something called Visual Force Framework, and we also looked at few basics of Visual Force pages. And now, let me introduce you to something called Apex Framework. So if you look at what we have got a basic Visual Force page with some static text in it. And whenever we want things to be dynamic, and when I say dynamic, I mean trying to fetch few records from an object and trying to display it to the user, so on and so forth. That is when we'll be associating this Visual Force page with something called an Apex class. And Apex class will do all the heavy lifting. When I say heavy lifting, what I mean is all the server side logic, which includes fetching of data, sorting it, making HTTP callouts, all these things will be handled in Apex classes. And the final output that we need to display to the users is what we'll be sending back from Apex to Visual Force pages. And Visual Force pages displays it to the users. And at this point of time, if things are not clear to you, that's completely fine. Just stick with me and you'll be understanding everything that we discussed just now. So the very first thing that we need to do is we need to associate this VF page with an Apex class. And the way we do it is we'll be making use of one more attribute called controller. So to this attribute, I'll give a name. And as of now, this Apex class is not created. Once after this attribute is used, we need to give a value to it. As of now, I'm giving this value. And this is the name of the Apex class. And as of now, this class doesn't exist. We need to go ahead and we need to create it. So just like how we looked at three different ways of creating a Visual Force page, we can also create an Apex class in three different ways. And let us look at them. So the first way of creating it is, let me click on File, New, Apex class. A pop-up will be shown to users. And this is where we need to put the name of the Apex class that we want to create. And in our case, this should be my fourth controller. And the moment you click on OK button, an Apex class will be created in the backend. We'll be looking at the other ways of creating the Apex class. So let me jump back to the org and here, let me click on setup. I'll make use of the quick find and I'll search for something called classes. It will show us something called Apex classes. Click on it. This thing comes up. So here we have a new button. We can make use of this button. And the moment user clicks on that button, we can see an editor. And we can make use of this editor and we can start building an Apex class. This is the second way of doing it. And now let us look at the third way of doing it. I'll search for something called pages. Let me click on this. These are list of all the Visual Force pages that we have created so far. And let me navigate back to the Visual Force page to which we need to hook the controller. In our case, it is my fourth page. And here, just like I have shown you earlier, I'll make use of controller attribute and then I'll give the name of the Apex class here. After that, I'll click on Quick Save. The moment I click on Quick Save, what happens is Salesforce platform throws an error. It says that Apex class so-and-so doesn't exist and it is giving us a couple of links. So the moment you click on any of these two links in the backend, an Apex class will be created. So the first link says create an Apex class which includes with sharing keywords and the second link says create an Apex class without with sharing keywords. We'll be looking at what these keywords with sharing means in the coming sessions. As of now, you can comfortably ignore it. So to put it straight and simple, I'll click the second link and in the backend, an Apex class will be created. So these are the three different ways of creating an Apex class. And I'll always be using the first way, which is creating Visual Force pages and Apex classes using Developer Console. So let me go back to the Developer Console. To save some time, I have already opened up the Apex class, which is created just now. This is the Apex class. And now let us try to understand the skeleton of this class. So here, public is called access specifier. And access specifiers can be any of these four values, which is public, private, protected, and global. We'll be looking at what these access specifiers are in a moment. And coming back to the skeleton of the Apex class, this is called access specifier. And followed by that, what we have is class, which is nothing but a keyword. This basically tells that what we are trying to build now is an Apex class. And followed by that is the name of the class, which is something that we have given. Followed by the class name, we have curly braces. And all the code that we write with respect to this Apex class should go between these two curly braces. So now, let me try to throw some light on all the different access specifiers. The first access specifier is public. What it basically means is, whenever a method or a variable is created with access specifier as public, then it means that this particular method or variable is publicly accessible and these can be used across the complete application. and the next access specifier is private. And what this means is any method or variable which has got private access specifier can be accessed only within the class in which it is created. And by default, if you don't mention any access specifier, then it is defaulted to private. And the next access specifier is protected. This means that the method or variable which is created with this access specifier is visible to any inner classes. And the final access specifier is global. And what this basically means is any method or variable which is created with this access specifier can be used or accessed out of the scope of this application. And this access specifier is mostly used when you want to make the methods and variables accessible in SOAP API or REST API. So these are all the access specifiers. Now let us look at how to create a basic Apex method. And coming to the skeleton of the Apex method, the first thing that we need to mention is access specifier. So in this case, it will be public. Followed by the access specifier, what we have is return type, and we'll try to understand what are return types once after we finish off something called data types. So for time being, I'll put this as void. Void means this method is not returning anything. And followed by that is what the name of the Apex method is. And after we mention the Apex method name, it should be followed by parenthesis, post which we need to give curly braces. One thing that you need to keep in mind is whenever we try to create an Apex class, will not have any parenthesis after the name of the Apex class. Whereas whenever we try to create an Apex method, we have to mention the parenthesis after the name of the Apex method. So this is the basic skeleton of Apex methods. In the coming sessions, we'll try to talk about data types, return types, and other things. So stay tuned.